Michael Schellenberger, a longtime environmentalist and candidate for the governor's position in the great state of California, has written an essay for the International Atomic Energy Agency, and it has resonated strongly within me, for it lays out a set of rules that could ensure the streamlining of future nuclear developments. Having followed Schellenberger's activities closely, seen him speak to regular people all over the planet, including people from Japan and Korea, amongst many others, I believe that he has a unique perspective on the matter, and I think that we can all learn from considering it. First, we summarize the 7 so-called secrets to cheap nuclear energy, as written down by Michael. Build national consensus around a long-term energy plan. Engage the public. Standardize to a single design. Centralize construction with a single experienced builder. Build as big as possible. Fix the price and don't allow changes during construction. And finance with low-cost loans. Subsequently, Schellenberger ends with a note that these are the only 7 secrets for cheap nuclear energy, and that the benefits of other deployments that are not based on the light water reactor are not so clear-cut. This is something with which I disagree, but only slightly. And this is predicated on the idea that it is indeed hard to quantify and substantiate the benefits of other designs since there's no practical development and deployment data. Let's consider Schellenberger's 7 points. Apart from the obvious, this is the first important point, especially the issue about committing to a long-term strategy. Sentiments in politics are fickle. Often, long-term visions are trumped by the possibility of short-term gain. How to get into office, how to secure a prestigious, well-paying job after your term, or some antagonistic short-term victory over ideological opponents. Rarely do you see politicians try to build up a solid framework that will ensure stability for decades to come. And yet that's precisely what nuclear offers. If you commit to a long-term nuclear development and deployment, you ensure job safety, economic benefits, power grid reliability for more than half a century. And that's where Schellenberger's 2nd point comes in. What does nuclear have to offer to the public? Some might say fear and damnation, but this is hardly what actually happens when a nuclear reactor is deployed. Fact of the matter is that one single nuclear power plant keeps thousands of people occupied for decades. Some people like to point out that the economics of a nuclear power plant are bad, whereas the exact opposite is true. Apart from being an energy generator, it also enables people by helping them to get meaningful, good-paying, stable jobs all around, from government jobs to people working on the plant, to surrounding jobs required to keep the plant going and keep the community thriving. When you build a nuclear power plant, someone else will build a supermarket and a gas station and a pharmacy and malls and shops and restaurants, etc. The list goes on and on. It is often said that renewables are the biggest job generators. I would love for someone to figure out how many jobs a nuclear power plant actually generates, not only in situ, but also as a spin-off of it merely being there. My gut tells me that it should be the best, hands down. We need someone researching this. As Schellenberger states, engagement efforts must be science-based, informed by the best psychological, sociological, and public opinion research available. And a social benefit study, as laid out, should be one of the essential first messages when people are engaged. What will it bring to you and your family and friends other than just energy? We used to build one-offs, which means that each reactor needed to be designed and built according to varying specifications. This is not a smart way to go forward. You want to build each unit the same with as much off-the-shelf components as possible. This is a way to ensure a steep learning curve in nuclear energy. Once you achieve this, you can move forward and manufacture components rather than build them. Your reactor should become a glorified IKEA building set, which brings us to the next of Schellenberger's 7 points. Building a nuclear reactor seems like a daunting task, and when you consider what has happened to several construction projects, it certainly looks daunting. However, there are companies and countries who can build their reactors on time and rather quickly. Think about construction times of as little as 4 years. If one manages to standardize a design and creates the off-the-shelf infrastructure required, one can build these reactors at record speeds. And the essential success factor is not so much standardization or off-the-shelf, but high-quality planning, supply chain management, and experience. Everything must be streamlined. The entire construction process depends on all the goods being delivered precisely on time, and construction workers must be able to go forward deliberately. This point, to me, is most critical of all. This one should be obvious. To generate the most energy for as little money as possible is to maximize profit potential and therefore the incentive to build one in the first place.
I don't really believe in small plant, low cost. We have nuclear plants that are shutting down. We need capacity. Like NuScale is operating at 29% efficiency, new nuclear plants are 35% efficiency. How can you justify that that's going to be cheaper in the long run? The plants that are being shut down are the single plants that are low power on their own. So how can you say that small plants are going to be cost effective on an operational basis? They're not. Right? The cost of construction per megawatt electric of a small plant is much higher than a large plant.
We've now seen plenty of nuclear power projects with delays and revisions, which have made those projects much more expensive than initially thought. Think about the EPR and the AP1000. When you have standardized your designs and have experience in building these reactors, you can sit down with your contractor and take through the usual timetable and discuss the price for the entire project. There may be some small discrepancies because of the layout of the terrain, for instance, but all in all, you should know exactly how much of everything you need to get the unit built, and therefore, it should no longer be necessary to negotiate deals. A reactor unit built in Georgia should be 100% the same as a reactor unit built in New York, down to the number of nuts and bolts. Schellenberger notes, the key to low-cost construction is low risk, not the estimated total cost. It is better for countries to go with a slightly more expensive builder who has significantly more experience and who agrees to a fixed price in exchange for a no-changes rule than one who offers a lower price at a cost-plus basis. And that's the key. The incentive for building the reactor within a set time and for a fixed price should be with the builder. They can build in their own profit margins, and the customer is ensured that they will have a finished product on time and at the agreed cost. You see these kinds of arrangements everywhere in the construction business. Those who offer you estimated costs and do not commit to a stringent timetable more often than not end up costing more money, and those who commit to a fixed price and set delivery date. Given the fact that a nuclear power project doesn't generate any income for about 6 to 8 years, including pre-building time, means that you need loans to pay for the costs during non-operational project time. I'll quote Schellenberger for this last one, as he said it best in his essay. Some of the highest costs that result from construction delays are simply paying the interest on loans. Avoiding high costs requires both avoiding delays and low-interest financing, whether from the government, the ratepayer, or an international development bank. The riskiest phase of the project is in the planning, with risk decreasing once construction has begun. Buyer countries should therefore have different financing for different phases. And that's it. I believe that Michael Schellenberger has laid out an excellent case on how to make nuclear cheaper and quicker without going into too much detail. He ends with saying that going with a proven design is safer. I slightly disagree. I think that the inclusion of molten salt reactors and pebble bed reactors is warranted, precisely because the amount of unearthed energy lying about in spent nuclear fuel pools and casks and depleted uranium repositories is a cash opportunity of immense proportions. But other than that, I am completely on board with this vision. So that was it for this video. I want to thank all the subscribers and commenters and supporters. You have helped me find new meaning in life, giving me hope that I can keep contributing to a better world. Thank you all for watching, and have a nice day.
Hey, it's Michael Schellenberger from Environmental Progress. So Discovery Channel invited me to go back to Fukushima for my second visit. I'd been there in 2014, and I just basically went to the plant itself. And I wanted to get back because I wanted to see the broader community. So when Discovery Channel invited me, I was eager to go. And we got a chance to see local communities, local farming communities, and really see all the work that the Japanese government had done to clean the place up. And in Japan, in Fukushima, they wanted to reduce the radiation levels to the very low levels that they had before the accident, doing a lot of soil remediation that they didn't need to do. One of the most fun parts of this trip was becoming friends with my co-stars, Joe and Angela. Joe focuses more on travel photography and Angela more on exploring the hidden parts of Japan. But they were super fun to hang out with. Gave me a lot of hope, actually, for this generation. Their own minds weren't made up when they came into Fukushima, so it was really fun to sort of talk to them about energy and the environment and sort of see their own thinking evolve during our week together. I think the broader intention behind the show was a good one, which was just to allay really widespread fears that exist all throughout Asia of Japan. And so I thought what was interesting was a chance to talk to the local residents who themselves still had pretty exaggerated views of what the accident had been, but also were really wanting to get on with their lives. Here's a trailer for the upcoming Discovery Channel television show, Fukushima Diaries.
Three individuals
12 Fukushima adventure
took up the call.
I just kind of want to go and experience and see how things have changed.
To explore Fukushima 6 years after the disaster.
I wanted to come to see the side of Fukushima that nobody really is very aware of.
This is their story.
What amazed me the most was the history and culture is very well preserved.
Fukushima Diaries premieres Wednesday, 29th of November on Discovery Channel.